good morning all. Today we are going to discuss the armature torque of a DC motor. Before proceeding to this, let us see the basics we have studied in lecture number 4. So we have seen there the force produced in a DC motor is given by force is proportional to I cross B, where I is the current passing through the conductor and B is the flux density, and the force is given by B into I into L. L is the effective length of the conductor and sine of the angle between the current and the magnetic field. So in order to produce the maximum force, we want my angle theta should be equal to 90 degrees. How to keep the angle theta is equal to 90 degrees? Always, I have to keep the flux in such a way that direction of the force that will be produced will be tangent at the point. The tangent at the point, then automatically we can tell that the force is maximum. So automatically torque will be maximum. So the remaining assumptions I am taking, let us assume the conductor is kept at a radius of R. So R is average radius of armature, it is represented in meters. Then let us assume L is the effective length of the conductor, that means the length of the conductor that is lying inside the magnetic field. Then let us assume that Z is the total number of conductors. And A is the number of parallel paths. The parallel paths we know, number of parallel paths will be equal to number of poles for the lap winding and is equal to 2 for wave winding. So that thing we have discussed already. Now next, let us assume that I is the current in each conductor. So this we have discussed that if total current I is given as the input, there will be number of parallel paths. So the current will be divided among the parallel paths. The current will be equal to the total current that is given at the input, that is the armature current that is given as the input, divided by number of parallel paths. So this I can write as armature current divided by number of parallel paths. So let us assume B is average flux density. Flux density is given in Webers per meter square. So now phi is the flux per pole and P is the total number of poles. With these assumptions, let us proceed further. So I am just representing the force produced by each conductor. So I am writing the force on each conductor. Let us assume I am taking it as F. F is equal to B into I into L. The force is represented in newtons. Now torque due to one conductor. So torque is represented by force into radius at that point. At the point where we are taking. So force into radius. This will be in newton meters. Because force is in newtons, R is in meters. So if I want to calculate my total armature torque, so total armature torque will be equal to total number of conductors multiplied by torque produced by each conductor. Torque produced by each conductor is force into radius. So Z into F into R. So that we have to take. So this I can write as Z into, the force is BIL into radius is R. This is my torque in Newton meters. So now I have to calculate each one. So we have just seen that I is equal to total armature current divided by number of parallel paths. And we know the flux density B is equal to flux per unit area. Flux density I can represent as flux per unit area. What is the flux per unit area? The area you have to take at the point where the conductor is lying. So at this point, how much amount of flux? So if you want to calculate the flux, you have to multiply. The flux density will be equal to total flux that is linking up to this by this single pole divided by the area covered by the single pole, or the area covered by single pole I can calculate as with radius r, the circumference will be 2 pi r. The circumference or this will be 2 pi r. This is my total area. Out of this area, each pole will cover 2 pi r divided by number of poles. So 2 pi r divided by number of poles, that will be my area covered at the radius r, because at this point how much value of flux is coming at radius r that I want to calculate. At radius r, the amount of flux that is coming will be equal to flux density multiplied by area. Area will be equal to 2 pi r divided by p. That will be the area per each pole. So that I am representing here. So flux per unit area, this I can write as flux divided by 2 pi r. 2 pi r divided by per pole, number of poles. This is my B. 2 pi r is circumference because I want the area, right? 2 pi r multiplied by length. Sorry, I have forget to give the length. So if you want to take the total area, 2 pi r into L. 2 pi r gives the circumference multiplied by the length. So this length gives my area divided by number of poles. 2 pi rl divided by p. So now let us try to substitute the values. So the armature torque or the total torque is given by Z into this flux. Flux is 2 pi rl divided by p into current I is Ia divided by A into L into radius. So this, if you substitute, this will get Z phi Ia into P divided by 2 pi into capital A Newton meters. Or this, if you substitute, I can calculate my value of Z A is 0.159 Z phi Ia into P by A Newton meters. This is my total armature torque. So from this we can observe that the armature torque, because 0.159 is constant, total number of conductors, that is also constant, and P by A, number of poles and number of parallel paths are fixed. Once the design is fixed, only variable will be flux and the armature current. This I can write as T is proportional to phi into Ia. So let us see for different type of machines. If you take a shunt machine, in the case of shunt machine, flux phi is nearly constant. So I can tell that TA is proportional to IA. And for the case of series machine, we know flux is proportional to the armature current. So the torque is proportional to armature current square. So let us see the relationship between the torque and the back EMF. Let us try to derive in the form. So we have already derived the back EMF. Back EMF is nothing but EMF induced, because the motor is rotating. Again, while rotating, the conductors will cut the magnetic field. So EMF will be induced. So that will be given by phi z n by 60 into p by a. This we have already derived the EMF generated. So I am just rearranging them. This I can rearrange as p phi z divided by a is equal to 60 into eb divided by n. So let us go back to the torque equation. So torque equation I am just reproducing here. So torque equation is 0.159. So from the torque equation, we got 0.159 multiplied by, in this form I want to arrange. We want to arrange in P phi z by A. So I am just separating that P phi z by A. So P phi z by A. And what is remaining now? Now Ia is remaining. P phi z by A, now Ia is remaining. So I can substitute that here. So if you substitute that, this P phi z by A, I can represent in terms of the torque. So if you just substitute and simplify it, you will get the torque equation as 0.159 into 60 into Eb divided by N multiplied by Ia. I have just substituted this. So this P phi z by Ia, so this I can write as Ta into Ta divided by Ia into 0.159, right? So same thing, I have substituted it, 0.159 into Ia. This is my armature torque. Or this I can further simplify as 9.55 times of Eb Ia divided by N. This is in okay. So this is the relationship between armature torque and the back EMF. We can take the torque is equal to Eb Ia divided by N. Now let us try to calculate what is the shaft torque. So out of the torque that is produced, all the torque will not be available at your output, because let us assume the total torque produced is some torque TA, armature torque. Out of this torque, because we know whenever the motor is running, there will be friction and windage losses. So that friction and windage losses will be lost. So there will be friction and windage losses, as well as the iron losses also generally combined here, because those losses contribute for very small percentage of the losses. So they are also combined here. So after removing this, the remaining torque will be equal to shaft torque. Or I can write that the armature torque minus shaft torque will be equal to your losses, which will be equal to 9.55 times of EB into IA. We have seen that is a power. So here in this case, the power loss will be iron and friction loss divided by N. So from this, I can calculate the values of the other things. So let us try to calculate the brake horsepower. Brake horsepower, the power that is developed at the shaft is called as the brake horsepower. It is represented in terms of the horsepower. So let us try to calculate this. So we know the work done per revolution is given by force into distance moved in one revolution. Because of this force, it has rotated by one revolution, so that gives the work done in one revolution. So this I can write as force into distance covered in one revolution is 2 pi r. So this I can write as 2 pi into force into radius. Force into radius, I want to take the power at the output or the shaft arc, so I am taking as TSH. This is in joules. So now let us calculate work done per minute. Work done per minute is equal to 2 pi into TSH. This is in one revolution. So let us assume there are n revolutions per minute. There are n revolutions in 1 minute. Per revolution it is this much. So total there are n revolutions in 1 minute. So I am multiplying with n. So let us try to calculate this work done per second. Work done per second will be 2 pi into TSH. Per second is n by 60. This is per minute. So per second will be divided by 60. This will become joules per second. This is in joules per minute. This will be joules per second. So joules per second, or this is also called as watts. Or this I can tell that output power, because it is in watts, this will be equal to 2 pi n into TSH divided by 60 watts. This is my actual output power. So this I can represent in terms of BHP. We know 1 HP is equal to 746 watts. So this output power can be represented in terms of HP. This output power is equal to 2 pi n into TSH divided by 60. If I want to convert to BHP, I have to divide with 746. This is in horsepower, because we know 1 HP is equal to 746 watts. Based on this, I have derived this. So let us try to summarize what we have seen. We have seen that the torque produced by a DC motor is given by 0.159 phi z IA into P by A, or the torque is proportional to phi into IA. So then we have derived the relationship between the torque and the back EMF. We have seen that the relationship between the torque and the back EMF is the armature torque is equal to 9.55 times of EB IA divided by N. And out of this torque, some amount of torque will be lost in the form of the friction and windage losses, as well as the iron losses. Iron losses happens actually in the electrical side. Generally, we represent them as part of the friction and windage losses, because they contribute for very small percentage. So calculation will be easy if you combine here. So that's why I combine here. So I can write the relationship that armature torque minus shaft torque, because that is the power that is lost, will be equal to 9.55 times of iron and friction losses divided by the speed. N will be in RPM. So after that, we have calculated what is the output power. Output power you have calculated from the work done per revolution, and from that work done per second. Work done per second will be the power. We got it as 2 pi n into TSH divided by 60. Or this can be represented in horsepower, that is 2 pi n into 2SH divided by 60 into 746. So with this, I am stopping here. So next class, we are going to see the remaining part of the DC motor, that is the speed relationships of the DC motor. So after that, we'll go for the characteristics of the DC motor. I hope all these things are clear to you. If you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.